I have to admit that it's a little bit different when we don't have that video up there for me to get myself straight, and then I sort of get crippled in the process. And for those of you who maybe haven't heard the story, I fell down a set of steps over in Shelbyville post office, ironically thinking that during the Christmas season that maybe I could work for the post office and deliver mail for them, because they're always looking for extra help time this year. But I'm still saying that God is sovereign. He had a different plan for me than I had for myself. So I praise Him for that. Maybe sometimes God, in His ultimate wisdom, protects us from some mistakes that we would have made. So
amen.
I believe He is sovereign. I believe He's got everything under control. And I selfishly ask for your prayers as I start therapy next week. And the doctor's already told me that the therapy won't heal it. It may help it. So probably looking at some surgery at the beginning of the year. So anyway, just want to thank everybody for being here this morning. And just pray that God in His ultimate wisdom will sort of keep us. I am so glad to see everybody here. And I think everybody knows me, but if you don't, my name is Rob Welsh. And I had such a wonderful privilege of being the lead pastor here at the church. But as our church grows and begins to grow, everybody I know has to realize that no one person can do all of this. So I want to take a few minutes and just celebrate some things that have gone on in our church. And you probably already heard most of all, most of them. First of all, you've already heard what a great fundraiser event we had through Forge yesterday. And we had so many people to help out. So many people were here. But I want to take time to recognize Callie and Tara and Rob, because they've been at this church along with others, but they've been at this church almost every night for the past 2 weeks putting that together. They've spent countless hours trying to get the donations wrapped up and get everything that came and that we were able to sell and bless others with. It was all donated. It didn't cost anything. So the whole thing was put together. Everything that comes in here was to the benefit of our youth group. But keep in mind, our youth group is awful. What did I say? Awful, that's the wrong word. They're just tremendously responsible with their money. 50% of every dollar that comes out, they give right back. They tithe their money. They give it back to the Odyssey Church itself. That's what that check's all about. They give 20% of their money to a young lady who is 5 or 6 years old. She's got some really terrible health problems, and they didn't expect her to live. She's a miracle of God. But, it's costly to go back. And even if your insurance covers the basic medical needs, it doesn't cover gas and things like that that go to the AIU pond. So 10% of the money goes to this family to help out this mother who's got this young child. 20% of the money they put out into other portions of 20% goes to her, so she'll get a check for $300. 10% goes into pies. 10% goes into an account for emergency funding, because you never know what's going to happen. And then 10% goes back into our local community. So 50 cents of every dollar goes directly into ministry, and the other 50% is poured right back into our children. They've been able to take them to Jolly Rogers. They've been able to buy plants and then go out in the community and plant them for the community. They just do wonderful, wonderful works. And so I just want to give them just a lot of thanks. And if you are new to our church and you haven't been coming here for a while, I hope what Tara said really meant something to you this morning, because we are a church. I really do believe that we are becoming a family. We don't welcome you here as guests. We welcome you here as family. And you find a whole lot of people on a whole lot of different scales. So somebody in this church is pretty much going through what you're going through, or something very similar. Maybe their problems are different, but they're just as important to you as what their problems are of her. And then we have other people in here that are going wonderful, and things are going great. So no matter who you are, there's something here for you, and there's somebody like you. And you can just get grounded here, and we're going to love you the best we can. And I think that we're making a difference. Yesterday, while we were going through this event, we had a lady who handed me a note, and this is what it said. It says, "I'm so glad that me and my fiancé found the Odyssey Church. not just a church, it's a family that loves and cares about each other. It's truly one of a kind. We really love the pastor and the directors of the youth group, and we're happy to be part of the youth group. Amen? So that encourages me. I take things like this, and I put them on a forkboard on the back, and when I get discouraged, because I'm human and I do, I go back and look at the number of people who give their life over to Christ, the number of notes like this that we get, and it encourages me, because what else can we do in our lifetime that's going to last all into eternity? And what we do here, it has eternal benefits. So praise God for that. Praise God for you all. Praise God for the people that come. And we just ask you, invite somebody with you. Come with you. And we know people have done that because we've got somebody new here today that somebody took the time to do that. Love them enough to say, hey, come and listen to this message. So second, whether you want to admit it or not, or whether you're ready for it or not, Thursday's Thanksgiving. And sometimes when you get busy, you just sort of let the calendar go on and you forget about these things. But whether we realize it or not, each one of us has so much to be thankful for. And you may be going through a period of time where it's hard to see that, and I understand that because I've been there. But one thing I want you to know, in our country, it's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but I do believe that we still live in the greatest country in the entire world. Like God in His sovereignty, for some reason, decided that we should live here in the United States of America. And whether you realize it or not, we still live in a country that has more freedom and more wealth and more possessions than just about any other place in the entire world. So we should be thankful for that. If for no other reason, we should be thankful that we have this God who loves us so much that He would send His Son to die for us so that there's a way for us to spend all eternity with Him. If He never did anything else but that, it's probably more than we deserve. I mean, here's a God who loves us so much that He desires to have a relationship one-on-one with each one of us. And if we take Him up on His offer of putting our faith and trust in His Son, we can know a peace and a joy and a love and a hope both in this world and the next world, even in the darkest of times. God is a great God, and we should be thankful for that. Now, as Tara said earlier today, one of the things I really love is an organization that we're part of as the Odyssey Church, which means you're part of too, and it's called the Christian Community of Churches. You know, the media today doesn't give a lot of good news about churches. They seem to take the craziest person and put them on the news and call them a Christian. It just gives bad names of Christianity. And Christians as a whole, we shoot ourselves in the foot more than any other organization, I think, in the entire world. We like to fight over the lowest things. We like to argue over denominations and doctrines and things like that. And that just reflects poorly. If we would do what Jesus said and just love, we would have the whole world being a Christian. But unfortunately, we don't always do that. But this organization does. It's called the Christian Community of Churches. And we lay down our doctrinal differences, we lay down our different theologies, we lay down all those things and say, okay, we believe. And 98% of what the Scripture says, we all believe the same thing. Let's not argue over the 2% we might disagree on. We're going to get to that and probably find out we're all wrong anyway. You know, let's just agree on what we know. And let's show the community how much we love them. So we're getting ready to have this ecumenical. Ecumenical is just a fancy word for all the churches. We're going to have this big service down in Bethany Beach. It's going to be held at Bethany Beach Christian Church. You go into Garfield Parkway right by the phone pole, you take the left at the stop sign, you take the first left into their church parking lot, and that's going to be held 7 o'clock Tuesday night. And the service is going to be called Thankful for the Thorns. Now, I don't know if you were here last year at this time. If you were, it's a modified version of that, but it is a tremendous, powerful service, I believe. It was powerful last year, and I expect God to show up and make it powerful this year. And I have the privilege this year, every year there's a different speaker for Easter and Thanksgiving and all the things that we do. I have the privilege this year of being able to bring the message. So if you want to come out Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, we welcome you. I do believe if you know somebody who's going through a difficult time, the message is called Being Thankful for the Thorns, Seeing God Even in Through Life's Problems. This message is for both the church and the unchurch. Bring somebody out. Come and join us. I think you'll truly enjoy it. And I think it's going to be one of the most powerful messages that you will see during Thanksgiving season. not because of anything that I've done, but because of what God has done. Then Wednesday night, I know it's the night before Thanksgiving, but the way this series is set up, it'll carry on until the end of the past the first of the year if we don't do it this way. And then at the end of the first year, I'm not sure what's going to happen as far as surgery and stuff like that. So we are going to start this Wednesday night. I know it's right before Thanksgiving. If you come out, we'd love you to come out. It's a new small group called The Journey. The subtitle is Walking the Road to Bethlehem. And I'm real excited about this because it's going to be looking deeper and deeper into the life and the birth of Jesus Christ. I believe that it's going to give us insight into our own journey with the Lord. And we're going to follow the sacred footsteps of Mary and Joseph and others as they go on this trek to Bethlehem. So if you can, I'd like to see you all Tuesday night and Wednesday night. And finally, we got some great things coming up. It is hard for me to believe how close we are to Christmas. There's only, believe it or not, 4 more Sundays until Christmas. So with 4 more Sundays to Christmas, that means the church heads into this, what's called the season of Advent. And if you were here last year, then you know that during the season of Advent, we have some great surprises for you. And if you're not sure what Advent is, or you like surprises, you know, just come on out and join us for that stuff until the end of the year, which is only 5 more Sundays, believe it or not. 5 more Sundays, and we're in 2016. Like I said, if you were here last year, then you know we have a lot of surprises during this time of year, and they're going to be coming up in the next 4 weeks. And even if you do know what Advent is, even if you don't like surprises, we're going to ask you to come back next week. And next week is a very special week on our calendar. You know, we've tried to make it as easy as possible to invite people to church. And next week is one of those weeks where we make it even easier than usual, because it's hard sometimes to invite somebody to come to church, but it's never hard to invite somebody to come eat free food. So next Sunday is what we call Leftover Sunday. We did it last year, and it was a wonderful, wonderful time of fellowship. We know everybody at the end of the year, after Thanksgiving on Friday, you wake up and you look at your refrigerator, you got all this food that's left over, you don't know what you're going to do with it. Well, bring it here. It's Leftover Sunday. Bring all your Thanksgiving leftovers here, and after the service, we're going to put the chairs up and the tables out, and we're going to share what our Thanksgiving leftovers are. I'll make sure that there's a turkey here, and if you like a list of things that I like, you know, you haven't cooked your dinner yet, you just see me at the service, I'll tell you what I like. Macaroni and cheese is right at the top of the list. I want you to know that. Mashed potatoes. But anyway, we're all going to break bread together and enjoy a meal, and we have pictures of last year. And folks, if you don't know Jesus Christ, I'm just praying that before the end of the day that you make him your Lord and Savior, because we had at least one person in pictures from last year that expected to be here this year and is not here this year. So you just don't ever know. You just don't ever know. But we're going to have a great time of fellowship. We're going to have time to just enjoy like a first century church. Sit down and have a meal and a blessing. And in the first century church, the way they did it is everybody brought something in, and it didn't matter whether you were rich or you were poor. Everybody got to eat off the same table. We're going to do that this year as well. Now, this morning, I want to tell you, I'm super excited about this message. But I have to tell you, this is a message for those of us who call ourselves Christians. So if you've never made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, if you don't quite, not yet, you know, maybe you're on the cusp, but you just haven't made your mind up that Jesus is who he says he is, we don't have to do anything we talk about today. You get a pass on today's message. Now, I'm hoping that you just don't tune me out, because one or two things could happen. First of all, you could leave here, get in your car, and say, you know, I was pretty much right. Some Christians are as crazy as I thought they were, and never come back again. However, what I've been praying for will happen is when you leave here, you say to yourself, you know, I think God does want to do something in my life, and I think he does want to do something in the lives of the people around me, and maybe I'll just keep following him to see if he is who he says he is. So that's what I'm praying. So just don't tune me out. The reason I say this message is for Christians is because we're going to talk about something that a lot of churches don't even talk about anymore. And when they do talk about it, you know, they talk about him in the wrong concept. You know, they put these things out there, and it's really not what I want to talk about today. And what I want to talk to you about today is revival. Revival is something, if we're going to talk about it today, is a movement for God. So the reason I say this message is for Christians, it's because according to Jesus himself, in order to see the kingdom of heaven, you have to be born again. Now, I know that if you're not familiar with Scripture, that if you're not a Christian, if you haven't followed Jesus, you might say, born again, that's just, I don't get that. That's sort of confusing. That's sort of strange. And I understand that, and that's okay, because when Jesus spoke these words to a man named Nicodemus, Nicodemus was confused. And Nicodemus was a man who was very well educated in the Scriptures. He was very well educated in what we call the Old Testament. So when Jesus was explaining this to him, Nicodemus was like, you know what? I'm born again. What do I do? I'm too big, How do I do that? So if you find this a little strange, a little weird, it's okay, because you'd be in really good company. Now, the concept of being born again, as Jesus goes on to explain it to Nicodemus, and I'm sort of simplifying the Scriptures here, Jesus said, you have to believe in me. You have to believe in that I am truly who I say I am, that I am God himself, and you have to put your faith and trust in me. And when you do that, the Holy Spirit dwells inside of you. So you get this second birth. You get this birth where your first birth is through water, through your physical birth. Your second birth is through the Spirit, your spiritual birth. And since we're going to be talking about something that can only come through God's Spirit today, this is designed for those of us who have asked Jesus Christ to be Lord over our house, and his Holy Spirit dwells in us. So if you're not a Christian, it sort of sounds confusing, it's okay. You'd be in really great company, and hopefully by the end of the day, I sort of explained it, and it'll make a little bit more sense to you. But this concept of being born again is so important that not only did Jesus speak about it, but the Apostle Peter, when he wrote his gospel, or wrote his letters, the Apostle Peter speaks about it. When John wrote his gospel, John speaks about it. Luke, who was very methodical, a doctor, who did a lot of research when he wrote his second letter, the book of Acts, he wrote about it. The Apostle Paul, who wrote in at least 7 of the 13 letters that almost all theologians agree that he wrote, 14 letters, if you believe, as some do, that he wrote the book of Hebrews. So in at least half of Paul's letter, he mentions this second birth. This theme is so important. Not only did the apostles write about it, not only did Luke write about it, not only did Peter write about it and John, but Jesus' own brother James writes about it as well. So this second birth, this idea of this spiritual birth, has to be very important to God. In fact, Jesus told Nicodemus that you can't even enter into the kingdom of God without being born again. So like I said, in a way, when you become a Christian, you have two birthdays. You have your physical birth through water, and then you have your spiritual birth through the Spirit of God. Amen. And since revival has to do with God's Holy Spirit, and you can't revive something that's never lived, then this message is for those who have been born again. Revival, by definition, means restoration to life. You can't revive something that's never had one. So when it comes to the church, it's enlivening, it's a quickening, it's an awakening of those who are lethargic and sleeping in the church. It's for those that are lukewarm in the church. And all of a sudden, this power of the Holy Spirit comes upon them, and they become to be humbled, and they can be convicted of their sin. And then as a result of this quickening and this awakening, they begin to pray, and they begin to seek God's face. But the problem with today's world, like so many things, including our gospel, I believe, here in the United States, we sort of watered down what revival means. If you spoke to somebody in the 17th or 18th century, or even the early 19th century, when you said revival, they know exactly what you were talking about. But today, we sort of put it on an event, on a calendar, and say, we're going to have revival next weekend. And we bring in these guest speakers, and we have 2 or 3 days that we call revival. We have these special messages. That's not revival like we're talking about in the context today. Now, if God shows up, it can become a revival. But the way most churches today, it's simply an event. It's not a true Holy Spirit revival. It's just an event that we put on the calendar. But if God shows up, it'll become a revival. The body of Christ, the church, will get on fire, and we'll leave these doors, and we'll go outside into the community, and we'll go out in the world, and we will be the body of Christ. We will be the church, and not a church. When a true Holy Spirit of God comes on, revival happens. When the Spirit of the Lord comes on, we'll be anointed. We'll be anointed to bring the good news to the poor. Those who are in captive of their sins will be released. Those who are spiritually blind will be able to see. The oppressed will be set free. And we'll know that the time of the Lord's favor has come.
Amen.
If revival happens, you're going to know it, because it can't come from us. It can only come from God. When we say revival, so often too, the second thing is, as we think about it in a context of bringing sinners to God, we're talking about sinners being converted, a new interest in the things of God. But technically speaking, revival has nothing to do with the salvation of the lost. Now, when revival happens, I want to assure you this. When it truly happens, new power comes into the speaking and the preaching of the pastors. New power comes behind the church, born again. But the main characteristic of revival is this extraordinary new life of the members of the church itself, as they get this new passion for God and the things of God and the kingdom of God. And a direct result of that is this newfound passion, this direct result of that newfound passion will be extraordinary evangelism, which will lead a lot of people to put in their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ and make Him Lord over their lives. People who've been outside the body of Christ are indifferent. They don't care about the things of God. They're dead in their sin. Then they begin to repent. They begin to make Jesus Christ the Lord of their lives. But that's not revival itself. That's a result of revival.
Amen.
Okay? So when sinners come to Jesus Christ and born again, that's called regeneration. Therefore, if you've never ever taken the thought, or it's just never, have you been indifferent about it? If you never asked Jesus to be the Lord and your Savior, then that's the first step. That's the first thing you need. You don't need revival first. You need to be born again.
Exactly.
So before you can know the peace of God, you have to make peace with God.
Yes.
Right? So to make peace with God, yeah, you have to go through His Son, Jesus Christ. So the first question I have for you this morning is, have you ever by faith received Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior? Because the Bible's clear. We can argue over a lot of things, but we can't argue over some of the things that the Scripture says. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." None of us can make it to heaven on our own. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death." Even if we were able to live a perfect life, never sin, never have a lustful thought, never get angry, never do any of the things that the Scriptures tell us not to do from this point forward, we would still have to deal with the sin of our past. And the wages of sin is death. So before you can know the good news, you have to know the bad news. And the bad news is you can't make it into heaven by being good. Nowhere in the Scriptures, this was a realization that somebody pointed out to me, I didn't even realize. Nowhere in the Scriptures, nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get to heaven by following the Ten Commandments. It's not there. Because there's no way to do it. The Bible makes it clear we're all sinners, and as sinners, we can never save ourselves. We've sinned against the Holy God, and the Holy God demands His wrath. We're deserving. So what's the good news? How can a person know his forgiveness of sin and become a child of God? John, the only apostle to live out a full life, he writes in chapter 1, verse 12, "As many as received Him, as many as received Jesus Christ to themselves, He gave the right to become children of God to those who believe in His name." If you're not taking this first step, if you're not asked Jesus into your heart, if you're not asking to be Lord of your life, I invite you this morning. That's what these altars are for. That doesn't mean that you can't do it from the chair you're in right now. But my opinion on that is, Jesus died publicly for you on the cross. Why not publicly pronounce Him as your Lord and your Savior?
Amen.
So if you want to do that this morning, any time in the service, these altars are always open. Just tell them, "Lord, I know I'm a sinner. And I know I can't save myself. I believe what the Bible says about you. I believe what you said about yourself. I believe you died for me. I believe you shed your blood for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead. And I'm receiving you as my Lord and Savior and my only hope of salvation. And then you know what you do? Barbara would tell you to do this. You claim that promise. You make it real in your life. Romans chapter 10, verse 9, God promises you. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But that won't be revival. That's restoration. That's new life. That's regeneration. Revival means to return to consciousness. Something which had life and now doesn't have life, that's life again. And if we experience revival, if we now understand revival, let me assure you, sinners will find salvation. But revival is for those of us who call ourselves Christians. Those that are dead in the church, not dead in our sins, but we're dead in the church and we become alive once again. And how many of you know people that once we're on fire for Jesus, once we're on fire for God and the things of God and the kingdom of God, it's all they can talk about, it's all they can do, and today they sort of sit back and it becomes more routine. You know, it's just like something they feel like they have to do. You know, somewhere, somehow, along the way, they just seem to have lost their passion. See, revival is a time of refreshing and renewing and restoring and rejuvenation and rejoicing. Revival is God having his way in your life and in my life. Revival is the return of God or return of people to God. It's the return of God's people to the Word of God, by the power of God, according to the plan of God, under the direction of God. And therefore, we are receiving the blessings of God. But here's what I know, because I've experienced it. There will be a true Holy Ghost revival in this church and in this area. There will be people who got upset. You have to be prepared for that. The church starts to grow. People come to Jesus. And other people get mad. They say they want it. But when it happens, they just get angry. And there's a reason for that. And I understand it. I didn't always understand it. I'm beginning to understand it. Revival changes things. It changes people. It changes you. It changes hearts. And people just don't like change. You know, here's what happens. It's possible to have a revival and some people experience it and other people just get agitated. So again, as we start to wrap this portion up, revival is for believers. Revival is for God's people. But I believe this, and I believe this with all my heart. Revival is needed in our world today. Yes. It's needed in our country today. It's needed in our communities today. It's needed in our families today. It's needed in our churches today. And maybe more today than any other time in recent history. Today, more than any other time in my lifetime, for sure, because the morality of the country and the morality of this world is going down a slippery and a steep slope at a very, very fast rate. Yes. Those things that used to be called sins are not only tolerated, but they're rejoiced in. We sort of had this flip-flop in our beliefs. But here's something else I believe. I believe revival can happen. I think we're in desperate need of it, but I also believe it can happen. I pray as we head into the celebration of the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ, that God will lead us into this genuine awakening in our hearts. And even if it doesn't happen in the church, even if it doesn't happen in the community, that it would happen in our own hearts, that it would happen in your heart, it would happen in my heart. You know, because I think there's a special blessing for the individual Christian, for the Christian who's willing to meet the proper conditions and receive a spiritual awakening, to experience revival within his or her own heart. And we don't have to wait. You know, here's what happens sometimes. When we wait around and we're looking up and we're waiting for this spectacular movement from the heavens and from God and the Spirit of God, that maybe heaven will send a revival. The fact is, we can experience it right now. We can experience a special, a refreshing, a renewing of the Lord at this very moment. I don't know if any of you are familiar with a man by the name of A.W. Tozer. He wrote several books, great evangelist, great writer, great studier of God's Word. He wrote it in one of his books called The Pursuit of God. He says this. He says, "It requires a determined heart and more than a little bit of courage to wrench loose from the grip of our times and return to the biblical way." Now, if you look at the times that we're in right now, you know that to be true. It's going to take courage to wrench loose from the grip of our times and return to the biblical way.
Amen.
Whoa.
And he goes on to say, "What God in his sovereignty may yet do on a world scale, I do not claim to know. But I do know what he will do for the plain man or woman who seeks his place. And I believe I do know it, and I can tell others. You let any man or woman turn to God in earnest. You let any man or woman turn to God and let him begin to exercise himself unto godliness. Let him seek to develop his powers of spiritual receptivity by trust and obedience and humility, and the results will exceed anything he or she may have hoped for in his leaner and weaker days. Any man or woman who by repentance and sincere return to God will break himself out of the mold in which he has been held, and who will go to the Bible itself for spiritual standards will be delighted with what he finds there." And he closes this up to say, "We have the ability to know him if we will but respond to his overtures." C.W. Tozer is saying, rather than waiting for some kind of earth-shaking movement of the Spirit of God upon the church, each one of us individually need to get right with God and let a revival start in our own heart.
Amen.
See, revivals in the church are God sent. They come at a choosing of God's own timing. They are God's grace upon an undeserving church. But we first, individually, must learn to be obedient. If we're ever going to see a true, genuine revival, it has to begin in each one of our own individual hearts.
Second Chronicles.
There's a verse in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, which is very familiar to many of us today in our nation. Even if you're not familiar with the Bible, you don't know where to find. I'm sure you've heard these words before. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. It's starting to scare me because I'm starting to think like Barbara and that voice.
Hallelujah.
"If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land."
I will hear their prayer from heaven.
It depends on the version that you're reading. That's out of the NIV, actually. So, yeah, mine's out of the NIV.
This is what you get.
Yeah, that's the New Living, which I normally speak out of. I apologize. I should have mentioned that in the beginning. I am reading from the NIV, and there'll be an occasional King James in there too. So, for all you diehards, But what's true for a nation? We know that. You know, some people would say, "Well, you know, that was written 700 years ago, and it was written to a specific nation at a specific time." Well, God's Word tells us that His Word is the same today as it was for yesterday. And what's true for the nation is true for an individual. And even judgment, God judges corporately and God judges individually.
Yes, sir.
So if we're to have a revival in this country, if we're to have a revival in our homes, if we're to have a revival in our churches, it's got to start in the hearts of us. It's got to start in the hearts of God's people.
Amen.
It's got to start with me and it's got to start with you.
Amen.
And that's what all these songs were about this morning. Let's have a revival. Let it begin with me. Let it begin with you. If my people who are called by name will humble themselves. We live in a prideful country today.
Amen.
But if you claim to be a Christian, you need to humble yourself before a mighty God. You need to pray. You need to seek His face and turn from your wicked ways. This is how to have a revival. It's a personal refreshing from the Lord. And it may not be earth-shaking. It may not be spectacular. It may not change the nation. It may not even change our church or change our community. It may not even change your family. But what I can promise you will do is it will change you.
Yes.
You can know the presence of the Lord and the power of the Lord and the blessing of the Lord every single day. Don't wait for somebody else to start it or put some kind of an event on a calendar and hope it happens to you.
Amen.
Enjoy God today and every day.
Amen.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. So often we forget that this God, this creator of the universe that goes out forever, has invited us into a personal relationship with him. What kind of personal relationship do you have with somebody that you never talk to? Never sit back and wait to hear from? We need to talk to the Lord in prayer. We need to commune with him. We need to worship him. We need to thank him for his many blessings. And when there's times of troubles, as there will be, we got to thank him for sustaining us through them and molding us into the image of his son. Tell him of your needs. Tell him of your desires to serve him. I mean, Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Don't come in with these weak prayers. Go with mighty prayers. See, we serve a mighty God. It says that we may attain to mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. We need to pray boldly. We don't ask God to fill this church with two more people. The prayer this morning was, let's fill it with enough people, let's change enough lives that we change our families, we change our community. And who knows, if revival starts, we may change everything around here.
Amen.
You know, we need to, here's the problem. It does take a little bit of effort. You know, we have to say no to the temptations of the world sometimes. We've got to say no to the temptations of the flesh and the temptations of the adversary. I mean, we have to take comfort. And here's what I think people forget sometimes. We serve this God who's mighty and powerful, but we also have an adversary who's mighty and powerful. Mm-hmm. Satan is stronger and more powerful than you are. That's just a fact.
Exactly.
Okay? Humble yourself before God and ask God to do what you can't do. The scripture says when we're born again, when we make Jesus our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. And then we individually become more powerful than Satan because we have the power of God living in us. In fact, we're more powerful than all the forces of the evil combined. Don't try to fight this enemy who has thousands of years more experience than you do. He don't have to use new tricks. He's still using the ones from the Adam and Eve.
Right.
Don't try to fight him in your own power. Humble yourself and turn to God and turn to his power. The scripture says you are God's little children and you have overcome them because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world.
Amen.
If my people who are called by his name will humble ourselves and pray and seek my face. See, we have to seek revival in our own hearts. We have to humble ourselves and begin to pray. And we begin to seek God's face. But to truly seek the face of God, you should read what God said about God.
That's
you should
right.
read what God said about
That's
himself.
That's right.
We need to study the Word of God and turn the light of Scripture. Take that light of Scripture. It says, it's a lamp to my feet. Well, make it a lamp to your face. Turn it on yourself and start to reveal your own heart and your own lives instead of pointing fingers at everybody else.
Oh, amen. Yes.
You know, how often do we say, if that person over there would just get right, they're the one needs reviving. If they get reviving, we'd all be okay. But we need to look in the mirror. We need to look in the mirror and see that it's us who needs reviving. If we do this, then we're going to be on a way for a true, individual, Holy Spirit-filled revival from God. We need to seek God's face. We need to spend daily in God's Word. Psalm 119 says, your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. The word of God is a means by which God will show you his will. And even though most of us are familiar with the word revival, a lot of us even associate the word revival with church, what you may not know is the word revival is never mentioned in the New Testament.
That's right.
The term revival is not a biblical word. But that does not mean it's a biblical concept. It doesn't mean that it's not a biblical concept. The word revival in the context we think of revival doesn't actually occur in a word form in the New Testament. But we know the principle is there. We know the principle is in the Word of God. There are examples of revival all throughout God's Word in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, but the word revival just isn't used. And let me show you by example what I mean. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but almost all of us have heard the saying, the Bible says that God will not put any more on you than you can handle.
Right.
Do you know it's not in the Bible?
Yes.
That is not in the Bible anywhere. The closest you can come to it is 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has seized upon you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can be bear. But nowhere does it say he will not put on you more than you can bear. But that concept runs all through Scripture.
And in the churches.
And in the churches. But I think the reason God doesn't, this personal thing, why God doesn't put that in there, because we put too much on us than we can bear sometimes.
Amen.
And if he put it in his word, we blame God. But the concept, God will not put any more on us than we can bear, is throughout the Bible. But there's no verse that says it. That's why it's so important that you read the Bible for yourself. It's so important that you read Scripture for yourself. One of the founding fathers in the last church I served at, I told his son once he accepted Jesus Christ, he said, son, you get a Bible and you read it. He said, people are going to tell you all kinds of things. They're going to make all kinds of claims.
Amen.
But you read that Bible for yourself so you'll know the truth.
Amen. Exactly.
You know this word, you'll know where somebody's speaking truth or where somebody's speaking lies. But you have to know the word to know that. I mean, that's just good common sense, folks. If you don't read the Bible, not only do you lose its power to transform your life, you can be easily led astray.
Amen.
If you don't have a Bible, we ask you to take one. That's what they're there for. They're free. They're our gifts for you. And we have them there so that you can take them. We want you to take them. And if you know somebody that doesn't have a Bible, and you'd like them to have a Bible, we'd like the translation that I normally read out, take one of those too. And there are two, you know, before we get too far, you go home and get a computer program. There are two incidents in the New Testament where the word revive is used. In Romans chapter 7, verse 9, the Apostle Paul writes, I was once alive without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And in Romans 14, 9, in the King James Version, Paul wrote, for to this end Christ died and rose and revived. Christ himself was revived, he rose, that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. So, I believe the Word of God is inspired. I believe that inspired actually means God breathed. God breathed it into existence. God used people's life experiences. He used their personalities. But he inspired them to write what's in our Scriptures. That it's inerrant and it's in just original form, which means it's without error. It means it's I believe it's infallible, that it can't fail you. And the inspired, infallible Word of God says it has the power to transform your life. Now, I know this is truth because it has transformed my life. I'm not the same person that I was last year. I'm not the same person I was 5 years ago, and I'm definitely not the same. Harry will tell you this. I'm not the same person I was 20 years ago. This has transformed my life, and I've had the privilege, and I've had the pleasure, and I've had the honor to watch it change other people's lives as well. Now, I just have to ask you, if something is inspired by God himself, if something is without error, if something is infallible, and something that promises you to transform your life for the better, why wouldn't you take advantage of that? You can never be a victorious Christian if you neglect the Bible, which is God's Word.
Right.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. See, to have a revival in life is to realize our own spiritual condition. And that's difficult. That's humbling in itself. But it's essential to revival.
Amen.
We have to meet the requirements of revival. And when we do, we get to enjoy the results and the benefits of revival. But usually, here's what happens. We begin to pray and we begin to seek God's face. And what we find out is our spiritual condition is a whole lot worse than what we thought it was.
Amen.
See, Peter thought he knew his spiritual condition. You know, he told Jesus, even when Jesus told him his disciples he would betray him, Peter told Jesus, he said, even if all are made to stumble, if they're made to stumble because you, not I. I'll never be made to stumble. And Jesus warned Peter, Peter, yes you are. Peter says, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. Jesus said, listen, Peter, before this night is over, before the rooster crows three times, you will deny it three times. And we all know that it happened just as Jesus said it. See, Jesus knew Peter's heart better than Peter knew his heart.
Amen. That is so true.
You know, and one of the evidence that I see of our need of our revival is our criticism. Okay, we criticize, and I'm guilty of this. Okay, so you know, as Christians, particularly, we like to criticize other religions, don't we? And we don't always do it in a loving way like Jesus told us to. You know, we see Paul speaking to the Jewish and people of other faiths. He stands on Mars Hill, and he never once condemned the religion that they were at. He just explained the truth and told them why it was better than this one. And men got saved. But as Christians, we like to condemn others. Not only do we condemn other religions, we go farther than that. We start criticizing other churches and other denominations, don't we? If somebody doesn't worship like us, if somebody don't play the same style of music that we play, if their doctrine is a little different than ours, we like to criticize it. But if that wasn't enough, we get right down and dirty and we start to criticize the people in our very own churches. Amen. Christians criticizing other Christians. The ones that we're supposed to be holding hands with and worshiping with. See, if we don't confess our sins, if we don't turn to God and turn from our wicked ways, we miss out on the full communion and fellowship of the Lord.
That's so true.
If you don't read the Bible and saturate yourself with the Word of God, you can't have God's spiritual victory over your life. If you don't pray with God, you're never going to have the power of God. But all of this starts just by humbling ourselves before God. If you don't spend time with God in prayer, you're never really going to experience what God's best is for your life. I don't want you to sit back and wait for something to happen. I want you to make something happen.
Amen.
Don't wait for revival. Yeah. Start a revival.
There you go.
Revival is this child of God, living in the glory of God, by the power of God, in the forgiveness of God's Son. It's a miraculous thing if you've ever seen it. Every individual who wants revival can have revival.
That's right.
But we have to make up our minds that we want it. Each one of us got to humble ourselves and pray and seek God's face. And then we need to look in the mirror and we have to say, Lord, let me worry about what I see in this mirror.
That's right.
Let me worry about all those other people. Let me forget about everything else.
Never been.
Let me and you worry about what I see right here. Let me and you, Lord. Let's have a revival and let it start with me. John 1:8 reads, if we say that we have no sin in our lives, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. See, we have to recognize, we have to acknowledge our own spiritual need and our own spiritual condition.
Amen.
Folks, I have to know, I want you to know, just because I'm a pastor doesn't mean that this doesn't apply to me. I studied, I was reading this message stepped all over my toes. My prayer life has to be changed. There's some things I need to recognize, some things I need to do. The more I pray, the more God revealed to me. And you may not like it. You may not even like me for it, but I've been praying this message steps on your toes as well.
That's right.
We need to stop worrying about the church having a revival and pray revival comes to our own heart. As long as we point fingers at each other, as long as we stand in the corners and talk about each other, as long as we look at the splinters in everybody else's eye and forget about the log in our own eye, revival will never, ever come.
Right.
Won't come personally, and it's not going to come to the church.
That's right.
And I know sometimes in churches this doesn't become popular preaching, but it's what it's going to take to have a revival, a true moving of the Spirit of God. Once we see our own spiritual condition, we'll see our need to meet the requirements to have this revival.
Amen.
Right.
It's foundational.
And God makes it so simple. We just come to Him and we confess our sins and then we accept His pardon. It's a gift.
That's a brilliant.
God's renewing of God's people. And let me show you in the Old Testament, which is a spiritual picture, our physical picture of spiritual truths. In the New Testament, we have the day of Pentecost. What a revival. 3,000 people got saved, and that continued on where God was adding to the church daily. In the book of Daniel, Daniel says, I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and making my request to the Lord my God for His holy hill. Ezra said, I am too ashamed and disgraced to lift up my face to you, God, because our sins are higher than our heads and our guilt has reached to the heavens.
Oh my.
And Nehemiah in chapter 1 said, I confess the sin we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you.
Mm.
So we have to look inside our own hearts have to see our own spiritual condition. And usually when we do, we find out that, and it was revealed to me, it's worse than I thought it was. But if we confess our sins, 1 John, God gives us a great promise. He gives us the good news of the gospel. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and He is just and will forgive us our sins and purify us. Purify us from all unrighteousness.
That's right. Great promise.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. See, God gives us these conditions we must meet to have revival for Him. Then He gives us a promise. And they're really, really simple. He says, this is all you have to do. But it does require some work, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
So most of us just don't do it. But God says, if you pray and you seek my face and you humble myself, and you turn from your wicked ways, I will hear from heaven. And I will forgive your sin. And I will heal your land. After we put all the human effort we can into this, after all the human efforts that have gone into making this church, after we've done all we can do to help people find and follow Jesus and lead them into a deeper relationship with God Himself, we have to remember that it's God who is sovereign. We do what we do, and then we wait for God to do what He does.
Amen.
We can't command God. We can't demand of God. All we can do is wait on God. We do our part. We humble ourselves, and we seek God's face, and we repent, and we pray, and then we let God do His work.
Amen.
There's a great story. Elijah the prophet is in 1 Kings, and I'm not going to read you the whole story, but you should go home and read it because it is a great story. Elijah the prophet is looking to call down fire from heaven himself. He says, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are the God of Israel. And Lord, I am your servant, and I have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back to you again. See, Elijah, he's calling fire down from heaven. And what Elijah is saying, Lord, is I have done everything you've asked me to do. I have done everything that I can do. But if fire is to come down from heaven, it has to come from you. It's all in your hands now, God. See, we have to wait upon God, because if God doesn't bring revival, revival's not going to come. God is sovereign. He's not to be commanded. He's not to be obedient to us. The scripture says in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. We are to be obedient to God, but God doesn't have to be obedient to us. God is sovereign, but in order to have a true revival, we still have to do our part. And then we have to wait for God to do His part. I don't know if any of you know the great evangelist. I love reading some of the history of even the United States and the world and Christian revivals. There was a man by the name of G. Campbell Morgan. He said, revival cannot be organized. See, that's what we try to do. We try to organize it, put it on a calendar, say it's the event. Revival cannot be organized, but we can set our sails to catch the wind from heaven when God chooses to blow upon His people once more. How will we know if revival comes? What's the result of a revival from God? Let me tell you something. Revival show up, you ain't got to bring in a CSI team to see and check it out and investigate. Crime scene investigators ain't going to be necessary to see if God has shown up. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my faith and turn from my wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive them and forgive their sin and heal their land. When God shows up, folks, you don't know. There is a putting away of evil. In fact, there's a story of a revival, and I can't remember if it was the Welsh revival or not. It was one of the great revivals of the land, and it was in a coal mine country. And as revival took place, the police department was actually put out of business. There was no more fun. All coal mining came to a halt, not because coal mining was evil, but because the people that drove the mules had quit cussing. And the mules didn't understand them anymore. True story, read it. True story. Because they were so used to the foul language of the coal miners driving the mules and the donkeys, they just quit moving because they weren't cussing anymore. When revival comes, God knows there's a putting away of evil. I mean, think about it. After the affair that David had with Bathsheba, the prophet Nathan comes to David, and when God revealed to David's heart what he had done, the psalmist writes, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit in me." Folks, I'm going to tell you, if revival comes in your life, you ain't going to be lukewarm anymore. Mm-hmm. See, we're living in a time when people could care less about God. A time of indifference. And revival cures indifference.
Including the churches.
Amen. In the book of Revelation, Jesus says, "I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth." Mm. Now, I've heard that before, and I'm thinking to myself, if I was Jesus, I'd certainly like to have somebody that was at least lukewarm instead of cold. Wow. Mm. You know what the problem is?
Yeah.
Lukewarm people don't warm up very fast. You get a cold atheist on fire for Jesus, and they'll do all the work in the world. You got somebody on fire for Jesus, they're doing all the work in the world. You got a lethargic, sleeping, lukewarm Christian in a pew, you're lucky to get them to move. Revival turns up the heat. You either jump out of the fire and become cold, or you stay in and you get hot. Revival cures being lukewarm. Jay Vernon McGee, I love his writings. A lot of times when I do study, I went to a study in Luke sometime in middle of 2016, I think it's going to be right after Pentecost. It's going to be a deep study going through Acts and Luke. Gospel of Luke, and then into the book of Acts. It'll be a long study. But we're going to use J. Vernon McGee as some of our study material, because J. Vernon McGee is this great evangelist, great theologian. But his father, J. Vernon McGee's father, said, if by some miracle God would change every indifferent Christian into 10 blatant infidels, the church might as well celebrate and have a day of Thanksgiving. Now, infidel means unbeliever.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what's this man mean that if you take a lukewarm Christian and turn him into 10 atheists, how's that good for the church? Well, J. Vernon explains it. He explains his father's statement. He says, it's not the blatant atheist in our midst, but the indifferent, inactive, lukewarm Christian that is holding back the power of God.
Amen.
So here's what we have to do. And this ain't easy. We have to go home and look in that mirror again and ask ourselves, is my indifference toward God and my indifference towards the things of God, is that what's keeping back God's power from my life and my church?
Very good.
A genuine revival comes. Bitterness and resentment disappears. We go back to Scripture in the book of Hebrews. Pursue peace with all people and holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble. And by this, many become defiled. Paul says in the book of Ephesians, do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking put away from you with all malice. See, when we're bitter, and we're angry, and we're resentful, we grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And Jesus said, on the last night that he was alive, he said, by this command I give to you that you love one another, alive in his bodily form. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. See, when true revival comes, we'll begin to walk in love, and there will be no bitterness and resentment and forgiveness, and love will be the norm instead of the exception. When revival comes, you're going to know this new joy in your heart. The book of Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is our strength. The book of Psalms says, will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? David said, restore me to the joy of your salvation and uphold me by your generous spirit. Now, I want you to notice something there. It says, by your salvation. Salvation never belonged to God. It always belonged to God. When David sinned, he didn't lose his salvation. But let me assure you, he lost all his joy.
Right.
When revival comes to your heart, it's going to lead to this humbleness that God wants. prophet Isaiah says, "For thus says the high and lofty one, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and a holy place with him who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble one, to revive the heart of the contrite ones." Contrite means to show remorse. When you're sorry, when you have this sense of guilt, God's saying, "I'm way above everyone." And when I look down at little man, I'm not looking for the big guys. I'm not looking for the guys that are prominent. I'm not looking for the people that are rich. I'm not looking for the powerful people. He says, "I'm looking at your heart."
That's right.
I'm looking for the heart of the person who's humble, the person who's contrite, the person who has a true sense of remorse for what they've done. He says, "I'm looking for the person who knows that they have a need, and they're coming to me with nothing to offer other than devotion." And he said, in that great need, they come to me and they bring me this great need. And even though I'm high and lifted up, I love to come down to my people and walk with them. Amen. He comes down and walks with that person, the man or the woman, this child of his who's humbled herself and has this contrite heart. We need revival. Let's not point fingers at each other and say, if that group, if that person would just get straightened out, then we could have a revival.
Amen.
I'm challenging you this morning. I challenge myself to go home and look in the mirror and say, "Oh God, the trouble as far as I'm concerned, and the only one I have control over, is this face I see in the mirror.
Change my heart over.
I'd like you to begin your revival with the face that I see in this mirror. I'd like you to begin your revival and begin it with me." Let me remind you, it's not the day and the hour in which we live. It is not the condition of the world. It's not the condition of the country. It's not the condition of our church. It's not the condition of the person sitting next to you. It's not the circumstances of your life that keeps revival from coming. God brought revival to his people in Babylonian captivity when things were much, much worse than they are today in the United States. The conditions of the people and your circumstances around you may be awakened and revived and bring new joy and new humiliation and new humility and new worship and new rejuvenation. That when we do, that the windows of heaven just seem to open up and God's blessings seem to pour down upon us in abundance. I remind you, rather than waiting for some kind of earth-shaking moving of the Spirit of God upon the church, we need to humble ourselves, and we need to seek God's face, and we need to turn from our wicked ways, and we need to get right with God and let revival start in our own heart.
Amen.
Revivals in the church are God-sent. They come at God's choosing of his own time. They are God's grace upon the undeserving church. But we first must be obedient if we're ever to see a true, genuine Holy Spirit revival. It's got to begin in our own hearts.
That's
what I'm going to leave you with, and I'd love to get down on the ground and do this. I'm just not able to do it. There was a great British evangelist by the name of Gypsy Smith. Gypsy Smith, he was preaching during the late 19th century, early into the early 20th century, and he said, to have a revival, one is to get down on their knees and draw a circle around ourselves and begin to pray. Lord, if there is to be a revival, I pray that it begins with me. As we begin to leave here today, I'm going to pray that God gives you a burden for the unchurched, that God gives you a burden for the poor and the widowed, that God gives you a burden for the needy and for those who are searching. Begin with the end in mind, okay? I want you to imagine this. Try to picture this in your mind. Imagine your household saved and serving God. Imagine your community working together in perfect unity for the glory of God. Imagine the Odyssey Church meeting the spiritual and physical and financial needs of those that are around us. What would it look like if revival came into your life and came into our church? Scripture tells us we have to purpose our mind. We have to make up our minds. May we be like Jesus who led the Israelites into the promised land. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Folks, revival begins with you and it begins with me. And we must humble ourselves and pray and seek the face of God We have to repent of our sin and get a burden for those around us who don't know the love and the hope and the joy and the peace that's found in Jesus Christ. Get a vision of revival where God shows up in a mighty way. Take action. Draw a circle around yourself. Get down on your knees and pray. Lord, send a revival and let it begin with me. Don't wait for a revival. Start a revival. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we pray that revival fires come down as we head into the Advent season, as we head into this season where we celebrate the birth of your Son. But Lord, as these revival fires come, let them begin with me. Show me my own heart, Father, and let me see me as I am. Encourage me, Lord, to read your word. Encourage me, Lord, to assemble together with others in worship. Let revival begin in my heart, but Lord, don't let it stay there. Father, we ask that you give us this burden. And we ask this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, by the power of your Holy Spirit and the authority of God the Father. Amen.